Hello, my friends, and welcome again to my video channel. Today we will continue our repair of the Minix MR73B. I made some progress. I think I found the solution what the problem is. Up to now, I've checked everything in the oscillator which I can check, except this capacitor here. These are mica capacitors. In the last video sequence, I think I said glimmer. A glimmer is a German word for it. It's a mica capacitor. They are in generally told to be very reliable and make no problems, but maybe we have a problem. So I have taken out the first one. These are the series capacitors to block or to reduce the capacity and variation of the capacity of the big capacitor here, of the variable capacitor. They're in series, and also to block the DC voltage from the gate. Okay, there's another capacitor here, but in general they are here in series for the frequency range, to set the frequency range. I've taken out the first one. These capacitors are here, these brown capacitors here, and the first one is for the band D, for the band where I have problems up to 30 megahertz between 12 and 30, where I have the problem in the low frequency range, 12 to approximately, I think, 16 megahertz or so, where the oscillator doesn't work. I took it out and then I will measure it and see whether we have a problem here. This capacitor has a nominal capacity of 10 nanofarad. I'm measuring here 9.3. I think it's okay, shouldn't be a problem. The quality factor is 258.57. It's very good. Okay, measured at only at one kilohertz. That's not a high frequency, but in general, I can say this mica is okay. I will solder it on provisionally and see what's the problem. Maybe some bad solderings or so. I'm not sure. Here you can see I resoldered this capacitor, this mica capacitor, only on the bottom side of the layer, not from the top side. I've cleaned the holes, but I only tack soldered it to the place where it should be. The transceiver switched on. At the absolute end of the band, I'm band D. At 12 megahertz, you see there's no oscillation, but then it starts at once at a very, very low, at the nearly the lowest frequency. I'm going to tune it up. Okay, it oscillates as it should. In the first original, I think it was at 16 megahertz or so where it stopped. But now we are at, it was approximately here or so. But it goes much more down. And interesting, you remember this ground connection here. It was this bridge here over the source resistor of the FET. There was a short, I took it out. And then let's go down to the lowest frequency, and then I squeeze on it. And then you see we have oscillation again. When I open it, no oscillation. So this bridge here now makes sense. I have to take it away with the... Okay. What did I do? I only resoldered some connections here. They looked good, a little bit gray, of course, oxidized over the years, but I didn't see any problem. So I will reinsert this capacitor from the right side, solder it, and see whether it's still okay. I've resoldered here now all the wires, connections, components, with new solder. The old one is a little bit gray. I'm not sure what's under it. It's not only a good idea to solder it with a new solder, you have to remove the old one. Best is a solder pump or some desoldering braid or so. Whatever it is, or whatever it was, now it works. I'm a little bit angry about myself. Should have seen this problem earlier. On the other hand, it doesn't look so bad when you see it here, these connections. This is the original one. I couldn't say there's a problem under it, but maybe some components oxidized. I will see whether I have a problem when I align it. Maybe I have to resolder it here and here also. These are the two first RF stages, selective, the preselector from the antenna circuit, and then the output of the first transistor. And this output goes to the mixer, and this is the oscillator section here. Okay, now to the result. This is range D, 12 to 30 megahertz. At the 30 megahertz setting, I will measure the frequency later, whether it's okay, of course. Then I go down where we had the problem, and when I come to the end, oscillation stops on the last megahertz, but again, when I make the short circuit again, then it can be tuned. Okay, what's going on now? Did I wrong? Ah, sorry, no. Uh-huh. Again, it doesn't work. It does the other. That's okay. But here the last. Oh no, still a problem. I've resoldered this bridge here, this shorting bridge. Now it is better. It was not sufficient only to squeeze it with my thumb. Soldering is always better. So this problem is solved now here. But there is still a very small range near 12 megahertz where the oscillation here stops. You can see it. One moment. Hope you can see it. It's upper scale here where we have 12. We are now on 12 here, scale D. And when we go down, oscillation stops on the last megahertz or so. There are no scales, no indication on it. Maybe this tells us that we have a problem. Also, the manufacturer knew it, and so he didn't calibrate it here. Don't know, but it surely starts on 12 megahertz, and the other band 4.5 goes up to 12 megahertz. 7, 8, 9, it is 10 here, 11, and we have 12 megahertz. That's okay up to the end, so we can up more than 12 megahertz, so it's rather easy also to tune in for 12 megahertz, but you see the amplitude drops. Maybe I would have to shift the bias of the FET a little bit, not only to make this bridge here. Sorry. Not only to make this bridge here, maybe the bias should be a little bit more positive. I will try it with a small resistor, add some voltages on it, and see whether it's better for the response here or not. I connected the resistor 4.7 megohm, 10 times 470 kilo ohm to the gate of this transistor, and fed the other leg, the other end out. That is this resistor here, you can see. And here I can connect an external additional voltage, DC voltage, and with this possibility. I can increase the amplitude a little bit better and increase the behavior. I go to the point where the oscillation stops. Band 12 megahertz. Here it stopped. And you have a second voltage with this wire. I can add an additional voltage of some volts to it. When I set it to 10 volt, I only have 1 volt at the gate because we have a resistor divider 10 by 1. When I increase it, the voltage here, you see suddenly the oscillation starts. When I go down to zero, nothing. I can increase it. I'm at 5 volt divided by 10. So I have an additional gate voltage of 0.5 volt. When I go down a little bit in the frequency, oscillation stops again. I increase the voltage. I'm at 6 volt, 7 volt. Stops. No chance to get it oscillating. So I think that there is no big progress for me. Whether it oscillates here or not, it's not so, I think it's not so important here. I will think about it, whether I do this modification, but on the other hand, I don't like to increase the gate voltage because then we have more gate current, and then I would have to adapt this drain resistor here. And now for what? I don't see any reason to do it again. Scale starts at 12 here, and without this additional voltage at 12, oscillation starts. So the owner has a receiver which covers the range from 12 megahertz to 30, and the other is a range from 4.5 to 12 megahertz. So I'm sure he will be happy. And such modifications are only for curiosity. But I think I don't do it. By the way, I forgot to mention why worked this micro cap when it was here. I got down to really to the end of the scale. And when the microcapacitor is inside the shielded box, it doesn't work. This microcapacitor seems to be very sensitive regarding external capacitive loads. When this frequency is very low and I bring a piece of metal close to it, then the oscillation stops. So the capacitive load of the surrounding seems to be a problem. So it would be better to install this capacity on this side. I've checked it, but I don't do it because I think it's better when it's inside the shielded box and I delete the lowest frequency range below 12 megahertz, which is not necessary here. I think it's a better solution to have this microcapacitor inside, because when it's here, it's sensitive to other magnetic fields. Here's a power transformer and so on. So I think it's better to have it in the shielded box, with a small disadvantage that the frequency range cannot be extended below below 12 megahertz. So I leave it as it is, and I live with this little gap on the scale. It's not a problem. Here I'm doing a first check of the oscillator section of this receiver. I've connected this scope here via the probe to the output of the oscillator. It's a probe 10 by 1. Connected it to the scope. And on the scope here, again, I can read the frequency also. There's a frequency counter in it, 7D15. For those who know the 7K series, 7D15 is a frequency counter, a timer, and so on. So I can read out the frequency. I set the oscillator. I'm in the range of 12 to 30, go down to 12 megahertz. I always should read the frequency 455 kilohertz above this frequency here. When I go here exactly to 12, I can read here 12 1.27, okay, some 100 kilohertz off, can realign it. Go down in the frequency where it stops. The level is not okay. Also increase it. The oscillation stops at 11.6 megahertz. That means at 11.2 megahertz there it is quiet. Again 12. Go up to 14 megahertz. I can count 14.16. Go to 18. I'm measuring 18.09. Okay. A little bit off. By the way, the band spread is set to calibrate, of course. We are 22.2, okay, not perfect. 28.6, this is 30. I'm measuring 33, am I wrong? 29.5, 30 megahertz, I'm a little bit off, 34, okay. I can readjust it with a small trimmer. There's a small trimmer for the end setting of the band. For curiosity, I will try it one moment. Assume it is this one. It's 30.4 now. Now I have 30.4 megahertz. Go down to 28. It's 28.28. Okay, I can adjust it. This procedure I will do in all bands. First check to see whether it's okay. With this method, I've checked all four frequency ranges A, B, C, D. They are okay within the range of some 100 kilohertz in the higher bands. That's a consequence of this simple circuit and schematic here. It's not a very precise receiver, but the advantage is it has a calibrator inside 3.5 megahertz and it generates harmonics, so it's rather easy to tune in the amateur radio bands, which are multiples of 3.5 megahertz. The old ones, of course. The newer ones are a little bit more difficult, but there is no band spread available. There are only band spreads also for the AM ranges for broadcast. Okay. Next step, next problem is I have to look for the non-operating BFO we had here. You remember, I couldn't get any tone out of it, so maybe the BFO is far off frequency or even not working. First, I had to reset this BFO knob. It was totally wrong, I don't know why. When we are in the center position between LSB and USB, the capacity of this trimmer here should be 50%. And this is a position where the BFO should oscillate at 455 kilohertz. And now one interesting thing which we have to observe when we go to upper side band into this direction, then we have minimum capacity. That means the BFO is above 455 kilohertz. This is typically the way to receive LSB in the IF. But we have seen the oscillator, the main oscillator here for the receiver is 455 kilohertz above the received frequency. So we have a frequency inversion. That means an upper sideband signal is in the IF section transferred to an LSB signal and vice versa. And the LSB signal in the input is transferred to an upper sideband. So here we have to consider that LSB and USB is not related to the IF. In the IF it is swapped. So LSB means setting maximum capacity, that is minimum frequency. So we receive in the IF an upper sideband signal, which is in reality a lower sideband, as we have here. Okay, a little bit confusing, think about it. And now to the frequency alignment. I've connected my simple counter. This generator also has a counter in it up to 1 MHz. That's okay for 400. You see, we are not at 455. I don't know why, what happened. Connected it with a probe. The probe is not aligned to the input. The input is 100 kilo ohm or so. But I have a 10x1 probe, doesn't matter. The counter is sensitive enough. I connected here the probe to the output. This is the BFO, as we can see here. And here we have an amplifier, and the output of the amplifier goes to this mixer. And this mixer here receives a BFO signal here, and the IF signal from this IF chain here. This is the IF part, and this goes to the base. The signal, the IF with 455 kHz, LSB or USB, goes to the base, and the BFO to the emitter. And I'm measuring exactly here at this point on collector of TR11. And as you can see, the frequency is 418. Don't know what happened. We had a wrong set knob for the VFO. Frequency is also beyond any reasonable value. That's the reason why in my first test I couldn't receive any single sideband. It's late in the evening, I should stop now. And then I have to look for a good tool. Okay, that's it. It's a right tool for this. The node needs 455. Oh, how was it misaligned? The knob is here, okay. And now I check it. When I align the BFO to upper sideband, you see it goes up. When I go to lower sideband, it goes down. It goes 2 kHz down and 2 kHz up. That's okay. And this is the center, 455. Okay. Dot one, zero. Okay, alignment is done. This should also operate. Now a small modification of the BFO. I measured a setting range of the BFO of approximately plus minus 2 kHz, but the manual here states plus minus 2.5 kHz. Okay, I cannot align this setting range. I can only align the center frequency here. But the setting range here is given by the capacitor of the BFO. And if there's no more setting range of the capacitor, so I have no more frequency variation, but there is a solution. The schematic in the manual shows that this capacitor for BFO, VC4, is connected in parallel to the oscillator circuit. This is a BFO circuit here. So there is no possibility to set the variation of this VCO only by changing this C33. With the core, I can only set the center frequency. But when I had a look at the C33, I have seen that the wiring in reality is different from this schematic. The wiring in reality is like this. The VC4 BFO capacitor is not connected directly parallel to C33. It's connected via a cable, a yellow cable, and a serial capacitor of 220 picofarad parallel to the capacitor of the oscillator. This original value was 220 picofarad, And this limits, of course, the setting range of this capacitor. We have a capacitor and parallel the capacity of the cable. And when this capacitor is too small, so the influence of this capacitor, of the BFO capacitor, is too small on the frequency. I made some tests, increased the capacity from 220 to 330 picofarad, approximately 100 picofarad more. And now I have a setting range of plus minus 2.5 kilohertz. I only had to swap one capacitor. I show you in the PCB. We have here the BFO circuit, that's a coil again. We have tuned on this one. It's a new capacitor here with the orange cap. This is 330 picofarad. Here we have the BFO transistor. This is oscillator. And this increased capacitor now guarantees or gives us a frequency variation of plus minus 2.5 kilohertz. And I will show you. That's the result now. The center is not exactly 455.0 because the frequency is not absolutely linear, but in setting LSB, we come now down to 52.5, that's 2.5 kHz below. Here we have the center frequency, 455, and the upper sideband here we have 7/8, this means 2.8 kilohertz above, so we have plus 2.8 kilohertz and minus 2.5 kilohertz. So it's a little bit more than plus minus 2.5 kilohertz. That's okay now. The reason is the receiver is a little bit broadbanded. The SSB filter is not an SSB filter, it's an AM filter. So we need also a little bit more setting range of the BFO to capture any SSB station. Without retuning, it's a little bit difficult to tune it, so the BFO should have some 100 hertz more overhead. It's always good to have this. Okay, BFO now is aligned. Next topic is to repair this mess of wiring for the scale illumination for these lamps here. The owner said he has sometimes no illumination. It's not, as I found out, it's not an interruption, it's a short circuit from time to time. Whatever happened here, I don't understand it. In another video from another YouTuber, I think it's D-Lab, I have heard the word coupler. And his best friend is a coupler. That means a coupler generates work and therefore he generates money. Okay, that's obviously here also has been a coupler. Pinched off a wire here, why? Makes no sense. Then this blue wire goes here to this connection, and then here is one, hope you can see it, less than 1 centimeter to this point. I assume this blue wire was here, and then the other blue wire went from here to here. But then this blue wire is wrong. Here we have short wire, then a red one, bridge, and for the last centimeter again a bridge. But this wire here is long enough to connect it directly here. We don't need this bridge here. So there's always a danger that sometimes when there's a movement, a short circuit appears. I will rewire it completely with new ones. Use for this here heat shrink. I don't have blue wires, and this wire here disappears anywhere in the chassis. I don't feed in a new wire, I simply make it better isolated. The wiring is new now. It's important to see that the black wiring is connected to ground here. This black wire, which comes from the transformer, 6.3 volt. Connected with this, so the socket, and the socket here is connected to the chassis, and this black here is also connected to chassis. Only this bulb here is potential free, but it's important to avoid any short circuit of the blue wire to ground. I removed all this. You have seen this scrappy wiring. Another important hint: if you have such a wiring, keep it away from the plastic. If there is a short in the bulb or in the socket or any other problem, this wiring may get hot and melt the plastic. there's a dark spot here, you can see it on the on the scale, on the white. Maybe it can improve a little bit here. You can see the spot. I don't know how this happened. Maybe the socket was broken, but it seems to be the old one, or it was not fixed properly. It hang in the air, so the hot bulb got in contact with this plastic here. Such a thing never should happen. Now it works when I switch on. We have light. When I touch it, no short circuit, no problem. It's all okay here. This is done. Another topic I have cleaned. You remember there was a wire hanging in the air. It was connected to this ground with a big blob. I removed the blob. Not needed wires. We have only the screen here of the, I think it's the IF output, which goes, this is the IF output. Yes, it goes to the IF chain here. This is ground also. Okay. Removed also this red wire with the connection inside. Here on the pot there was a second lead. It's not needed. It was not original. The pot has only one connection. It goes to the mode switch and changes between AM and SSB demodulator. Not more. It looks like someone has tried to install an additional audio output from the hot end. This is the hot end of the pot to anywhere. So he installed here a cable, tapped here the plus, and connected it to the minus here, to the ground connection. Looked like this or similar modification, but there was no module inside. I didn't find any connection to the outside world. Maybe someone started a project and stopped it or anything else. Well, this is also done. Next step is to make a thorough check of the receiver. It should work now, and maybe I will do some optical corrections on the scale. I will show it. The scale, there are indicators, marks for the pointer. They are nearly non-visible. Maybe I can make it a little bit better and clean it also. Here is some on one side here. Can you see it here? Yes. Moment. Here we have some black dirt. I assume it's from the felt. There's a felt or rubber to avoid that the scale touches the front. Maybe it's an dirt from there. I will try to remove the bezel and whether I can do some work and clean it. To remove this bezel here was rather easy, only 4 screws, 1, 2, 3, 4 here. Could flip it off, and now I can take off the 2 plexi glass covers to clean them and to re-scratch. I think it's only a sort of a scratch. This is a red, small red mark, which is behind the bezel here. Don't see that it makes sense. Cannot be seen. Maybe I can repaint it or not. I will see, but first I take off these 2 plexiglasses. I squeeze this plastic cover down. As you see it, exactly in line. So I can now re-scratch this marking, center marking here for the scale. It's necessary that this is absolutely fixed to prevent slipping off. When I would slip off, it would not so nice. I would have to redraw it and to make a new one, which is difficult because there's a black paint on it. So I have to be careful. This peak here should be a little bit sharper. I will do it. And then I make scratch, scratch. And now I will start. I seat takes several times. I have to do it in the other direction also. Okay. Now it looks good. Let's have a look at it. Okay. I think the difference can be seen. Looks very sharp. And now, same procedure for this one. Job is done. Both plastic covers look better. They are dirty. I have to clean them, but that's another topic. Cleaning this black trace here is rather easy. It comes off, so I only need some paper. When I'm careful, but I fear this dirty spot will come again. I'm not sure what's going on there. Not completely clean. I don't need any solvent, which is forbidden here. Not even water, only dry paper. This is sufficient. But I fear when I do it. Okay. We have the same problem with this side. Maybe I have to remove the rubber or whatever it is. Or it dried out meanwhile. I can't see on the rear side what it is. Maybe I have to remove the scale. Scale could be rather easy because there are only two set screws. A small spot. Okay. But as it looks, the problem maybe is gone with the time. I also clean this one. Now the bezel and the plexiglasses are back. We can see here what I've observed. The scale is not adjusted exactly. It should be a little bit more right because I'm at the end here and I cannot tune it further. So it should be a little bit shifted in this direction, 1 or 2 degrees. Same we have here. With the main tuning, the zero here is not exactly zero. Maybe you cannot see it on the camera, but this has to be shifted a little bit into this direction. It's rather easy. Scales have set screws. Maybe there's some realignment necessary, but that's not a problem. I have to check all the calibrations and then this can be done. Before I start the alignment of the hole receiver and the IF section, I will first align the Chrysler generator. It's a 3.5 MHz generator, which generates harmonics. So 3.5, 7, 14, 21 and 28 MHz can be calibrated on the main and band spread dial here, as we have seen in the front picture. This generator is rather easy, rather simple build. There's only one transistor and one trimmer. Chrysler. There is an output cable connected, you see. Well, it is not necessary because this generator is located very close to the tuning capacitor and the input circuit. These two caps here are the inputs and this is the oscillator part. So any electromagnetic field generated by this Chrysler here is coupled directly into the RF section into the input, and it's enough to generate a signal with an S9 plus, so it's not necessary to have a separate cable. I connected my frequency counter and my oscilloscope here to this point of the transistor, and with this trimmer I will check and realign 3.500 MHz. Well, that's an easy job, standard procedure. This oscillator is some 100 Hz below 3.5 MHz, but it doesn't matter. The accuracy of the old analog scales here on this receiver are not very good, the accuracy, so it's not relevant, not important whether this crystal generator here is accurate in the range of some 100 Hz or so. We can live with it. On the other hand, when I remove this probe here, maybe the frequency will jump up a little bit, but it's a high ohmic probe, 10 mega ohm. We can live with it, and now we will start the main alignment. Here we have the coils and trim capacitors which have to be aligned. This section here is the oscillator, and for each band we have a coil and a capacitor. Coil, capacitor, coil, capacitor, coil, capacitor, to set the upper and the lower frequency limit. And these two chambers here are the two preselector stages, and each stage always has an inductivity capacitor for each band on the input and on the output side. So we have a double preselector stage. All cores seems, as I see so far, okay, except one core which is broken here. I've seen it is split, this one, and I have no chance to get it out from this side when I use a plastic screwdriver or similar like this. The split core is blocking, and so I have to try to get it out from the bottom side, from the other side. But unfortunately, this is this coil here, and there is no hole in it. There are no holes on the lower side, so I will drill here a small hole so I can get squeeze my screwdriver in, and hopefully I can get out this core, assuming that there is a slot or something like this on the top side of the core. Otherwise I will have a big problem. I will drill a small hole and then increase the hole step by step until it's possible to insert a screwdriver. Now a little bit bigger drill. From a certain diameter on, I work with a manual drill, not with a machine, because the danger to slip into the hole is too dangerous with a machine, so I will do it by hand. Slowly, very slowly. And you can see it also. It works, and I have a much better feeling. This hole here is now 3 millimeters, and I can see a slot inside from the core. So I will drill up the hole to 3.5 millimeters, and then I think I have enough space for a broad screwdriver. I need a broad screwdriver with a big blade to avoid a second damage from the other side of the core. This would be the worst case for me, so I will try to have access with a good screwdriver. This core here is fixed with some red paint or so. What this is, I don't know exactly, but it is dried out very hard, so I will try to remove it with the dentist tool out of the thread to get this core a little bit more better moving. It's not so easy not to disturb it. On the other hand, it's necessary to get it out from the thread. Otherwise, I have no chance from the lower side to get this core out. it's a difficult work. I hope it's not necessary to solder out this core here. This coil would be ugly. And now I have success. It's like a surgery. I work like a dentist. There's a big part broken, and this big part here blocked the thread inside, so it was not possible to get this core out in this direction here as I intended it, because when I turned it from the other side, this part here blocked the thread. But now it moves, and it's rather easy now. You see, very carefully, turn by turn, and you see the heavy damage. Okay. You can see it here. Damaged it is. There's a big part broken away from the core. This is done. Gentlemen, whenever you try to realign such a receiver, be extremely careful. Don't over tighten these cores. You see what happens. There's still some crack inside here. I have to take it out. I have to clean it carefully, and then I can, maybe I need a new core. Don't know whether this is sufficient for the good alignment here. Anyhow, the core is out. That's important. And now we are at the end of part two of this project. In part three, we will continue with the alignment, some basic measurements and tests. Stay healthy. Stay tuned. See you.